want to welcome to our show. We have a world-renowned artist, Isabel Pitsek. And Isabel lives in California now, but she's originally from Hungary, and in fact escaped from Hungary at the age of 14. And now we talked about this, Isabel, before, and at the age of 14, you submitted a sketch, if you will, a proposal for a mural to be painted in the Vatican. And out of dozens of submissions by professional artists, your art was selected. And explain that to me. How that seems so remarkable.
Well, I have submitted a painting to an international exhibition in Rome, and I have won the International Grand Award for mural, for painting. And so the priests noticed me, so to speak, and they suggested that I should submit a sketch together with so many other people. And they didn't, we had to include into an envelope our plans with just a number. Mm-hmm. And the number was registered with the name with the office. And so they didn't know that I'm just a very young girl. And the famous art historian Father Kirschbaum and several other art critics chose my work. It was selected. And so first, when they learned that I'm just a little girl, they were very nervous about this project. And then I had to prove my abilities by executing one-third of the mural cartoon, the original mm-hmm. size drawing. And that was judged again by these famous people, and again I was selected, so I got the paint, the mural, and with your kind permission, I will show it to your audience.
Okay.
Right now.
Isabel, what are we looking at here?
This is the mural in the Pontifical Biblical Institute in the Vatican. It's 400 square feet, representing the second miraculous fishing with twice life-size figures. Another mural I like to show to you. Here you see me on the mm-hmm. scaffold visiting with a shaky reporter who didn't like to climb that high. This mural is 70 feet high. We are about 70 feet high.
Now this is fairly recent, what we're looking
at
here.
Yes, it's fairly recent. It's at the Guardian Angel Cathedral in Las Vegas. And so far, that is my most famous work.
And the one we saw first was the one you did when you were 14 years
yes,
old?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay,
yes,
okay.
That's right. And this is the finished mural. As you see, it goes way up into 70 feet. The figure of Christ in the center, the risen Christ, is seven times life size.
Seven times life
yes,
size.
It's
that's enormous. It's 70 feet high?
Yes, the mural is 70 feet high. This is supposed to be the fifth largest figure ever painted in modern art history. And this is a gigantic stained glass on which I am working now. I am working on the two sides of this huge stained glass
alcove. So this is a work in progress right now?
In progress right okay. now. This is 560 square feet, and the two sides are about 1,000 square feet.
Oh, that's
altogether.
Enormous.
Yes.
Isabel, you certainly are an accomplished artist, even at the age of 14. And one of the reasons that you're here on the Shroud Report is because you are a devotee of the Shroud. And as an artist, you're convinced that the Shroud of Turin is not the work of an artist. And I think I would like, and our audience would like to hear from the perspective of a professional artist like yourself, why you are so convinced that the Shroud simply cannot be the work of an
yes.
artist.
I am most grateful for this question, because I always feel that it is the professional artist, he should answer the question whether or not the Shroud is a painting. Mm. After all, we make the paintings. And we cannot forget that art and a painting on a wall or on a canvas is an optical illusion. People mm. don't think of that. An optical illusion which is created by the marriage, so to speak, of the art mediums and the pigments. Mm-hmm. something is not a painting if just one of these items exists on a painting. They create the illusion in your art that you are in your eyes that you are looking at a painting. Mm-hmm. So some of our own experts, even almost everyone, commits one mistake. You don't start with analyzing paint pigments. It's just dust, it's nothing. You analyze the mediums. And in the Middle Ages, the mediums were emulsions, mm-hmm. water soluble colloidal emulsions. That's the professional name for them. Egg tempera, or gum tempera, or glue tempera. These are the emulsions.
So the emulsions is the solution, the kind of liquid.
Yes.
That
yes.
the various pigments were dissolved in and
yes.
mixed up in,
yes.
and then later on painted onto whatever the surface that
yes.
they were painting on.
Yes, exactly. Okay. You see it so well. And these pigments are suspended mm-hmm. in the medium. They are not like the thermoplastic mediums, which are oil paints, and they are completely one with the medium. These are just suspended. And they leave a definite and noticeable paint film, mm-hmm. always.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't see that on something, that is not a painting.
So in other words, if you have an emulsion that has a pigment in it, then that emulsion is going to leave a film. It's going to leave something on there.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And the most important argument is that this film created by the emulsion must be intact. The minute it's not intact, then you, parts of the painting are missing.
So if the emulsion isn't intact, then the pigment's going to fall away.
Exactly.
And then you have
yes.
no painting.
Yes.
And so what, relating that back to the shroud, is that, is there any evidence of any kind of an emulsion on the shroud?
Absolutely none. And since the shroud is a continuous homogeneous image, that you don't see any interruptions on it, maybe at the wrist a little bit. So it doesn't have any kind of emulsion film on it. It makes sense that it's against the laws of nature for it to be a painting. It's that serious. It's against the laws of nature, and it would be a miracle if a painting would exist without an intact emulsion.
Okay, because the emulsion
yes.
is what causes the image to be visible.
Yes,
and without
exactly.
the emulsion, you
yes.
there is no way for the pigment
yes,
to
no
attach
way
itself
to, yes,
the, to
yes.
the surface.
Yes, everything,
okay.
even pastels, charcoals have a certain, you have to use fixatives then.
Mm-hmm.
So this is perhaps the strongest argument. The second is that every painting shows a light focus. The light focus means simply that you know exactly where your light is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
From what side, from above, from left to right, etc., creating shadows and lights. You don't have any kind of light focus on the shroud.
So you have no light focus. It's,
no.
It's what you're saying is that from an artist's perspective, the artist crafts the painting with light coming from somewhere. From,
yes.
from behind,
yes.
from before, or the sunset with shadows, or
yes, yes.
Okay.
So there is no light focus. And
why is that? What? So if there's no light focus, what does that suggest then?
It suggests that it's absolutely not a painting,
okay.
because the artist has to create the optical illusion. Of some objects, rounded objects, like the shroud looks to be, with the help of a light focus, light and shadow, the chiaroscuro,
okay.
as the artist calls it. So that's the second very strong argument against the painting theory. The third is that the shroud has no outlines, absolutely none. There is no way through the entire art history that an artist could have made or could make a painting without outlines.
And that meaning outlining,
yes.
in other words, if you were to sketch the image of a human body, that you would begin sketching the outline first and then fill in from the outline.
Exactly. And even if I don't deliberately want to create an outline, like in art history, the pointillists of French painting, they tried to get away from the outline and divided their painting into millions of little dots. Even then, where the material ends, that's your outline. Mm-hmm. So you cannot create anything with that outline. And yet the shroud, under the greatest magnification, even it has no outline.
It just, that's the image just kind of disappears into the sides,
into
right?
Eternity. Into eternity. Yes. So
now we have some more slides, but I think we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back, and then we're going to look at some more slides that Isabel has brought. Hi, I'm Russ Brialt, and welcome back to the Shroud Report. And today we have a special guest, Isabel Pitsek. Now, Isabel, you are a professional artist, and what are we looking at here?
Russ, this is a slide on which I tried to show how many different disciplines an artist has to be educated in order to be really professional. One is art anatomy. You have to know art anatomy inside and out. You have to know perspective. You have to know foreshortenings. You have to know paint chemistry, mathematics, geometry, all kinds of different things which an artist has to know inside and out. And that leads me to a fourth, very important question, why the shroud is not a piece of art, not a painting. The artists were knowledgeable in foreshortening, art anatomy and foreshortening, only from the end of the 14th, rather the 15th and the beginning of the 16th century on. Piero della Francesco and Dürer were the very first who started to understand the strange phenomenon of foreshortening, which has something to do with your light focus. Everything
and
is...
And you, were, you is mentioned open, light focus before,
yes,
that every artwork has to have a light focus.
Has a light focus, and the light focus would cause the foreshortening, which is placing a body or an object into the lines of perspective. Everything is going toward a vanishing point.
Okay. So now, explain foreshortening with me. I've seen you present before, and there's a slide which we don't have, but you use to illustrate the perspective that an artist would have to have in order to paint the image on the shroud. And this picture that I have in my mind that I remember is with you standing on top of about a 20-foot stepladder, looking down on a model, a man,
yes,
who is lying there with his kind of shoulders brought forward and knees brought up a little bit and his hands.
Yes.
And so what is foreshortening and how does it relate to this thing called perspective?
Yes, when you place an object or human body into the lines going toward the vanishing point, the closer you get to the vanishing point, the shorter the body parts or the parts of the object or a street, for instance. You start with a 25 feet wide street, and as you look at the end, it looks like a dot. That's foreshortening.
I see.
And the human body suffers a similar effect, so to speak, and that's called foreshortening. It's very hard to draw a foreshortened body. You really have to know your anatomy. And when you draw it, a similar thing happens as to the human eye. When, you, for instance, I do with my hand like this, mm-hmm, then you see the foreshortening, but you don't think that I'm crippled. The eye...
Right.
Makes up for the foreshortening, and I still look a normal person. The same thing the artists learned how to draw.
I see.
Now that was not known in the time when they placed the shroud at. It was not known in 1260 or 300 or 1360. It was totally unknown. And the shroud yet shows strong foreshortenings. And
okay,
it is even more interesting why I say that it cannot be a painting, because it shows foreshortening without the aid of a focus.
Of a light focus,
light
right.
Focus. Without it, okay. There is no artist in the world who can produce that. They're absolutely impossible. So this is a, these four points are extremely important in this, that this okay. Art cannot be.
Now you have some more images for us to look
yes.
At.
Now, another very interesting proof is that in the catacombs, which I visited now year after year.
And these are in Rome.
These are in Rome, mm-hmm. Catacombs underneath the pavement of Rome. They are about 700 kilometers long and only partially excavated yet. I was down at the catacombs of Domitilla, the Callisto, almost every one of the catacombs. This painting is in the Marcellinus and Peter catacomb. I estimate that it was painted in about this, the, toward the middle or the end of the second century. And there is even an earlier paintings we found, which is from the first century. And these were held in great respect by the old martyred Christians. But then when the Church of Rome was accepted by the Roman emperors, Constantine, from that time on the catacombs were closed. About 800 AD the catacombs were mostly closed. These paintings were forgotten, nobody cared about them. They certainly had nothing to do with the Turin Shroud. And now when we excavate these paintings and look at them, they are almost totally similar to the Turin Shroud, the same face.
So this is the face image from the Shroud.
Yes.
And you're drawing a similarity between this image that has
yes.
been found in this, from the second century in the
yes,
in the Roman
first.
Catacombs. And
yes.
the yeah. what the point you're trying to draw is that these catacombs were hiding places, if you will, for the
yes.
early Christians
yes.
that were suffering persecution. They would hide out underneath under the ground in these catacombs, and they would paint these images on the wall. And what you're saying is that because this was so close to the time of Christ, that image that we saw right before the painting from the catacomb, your feeling is that that's probably based on either descriptions or based on other artworks that actually described that were based on when someone actually saw Christ living
exactly.
and alive,
yes.
And based on kind of eyewitness accounts
exactly.
of what
yes.
Jesus may have looked like.
Yes.
And then later on when we see the Shroud, lo and behold, there's this incredible similarity
yes.
between this a catacomb painting, which was probably based on some previous eyewitness to what Jesus looked
yes.
like, a remarkable
yes.
similarity with the Shroud.
Yes, exactly. That's what I want to say.
Why don't you go back and look at that catacomb picture again?
It's such a similarity. The proportions of the face, the beard, the hair, everything is exactly mm-hmm. the same. So how could it happen that there is a shroud locked away mm-hmm. for centuries? Certainly, this artist has never seen the shroud who painted this one.
Mm-hmm.
And the man of the shroud and this is exactly the same. So this proved that a man like this existed. There
existed.
Was a man like
right.
that. And that the shroud truly covered his body.
That's
so,
really a,
yes.
a phenomenal point.
Yes.
And there again so, is the shroud image.
Yes.
And then, of course,
yes.
there's a whole other line of talk or research that then compares the shroud with Byzantine images, and probably won't get into that during our discussion here. But well, what else do you have here?
Well, I just want to make one more remark that one of the strong arguments the enemies of the shroud have that oh, somebody made up this face and it was repeated and repeated and repeated and became a tradition. There is no such tradition because this image in the catacombs was not a tradition. It was the true likeness painted, inspired by somebody who has seen Christ, because we even found first century paintings. So there is no question that somebody has seen Christ and described him. So it's not a made-up image, it's not the artist's imagination, and yet we find the shot which is exactly the same.
Right.
So this is a very strong proof. And here I like to show how a painting looks, which we mentioned earlier, when the paint medium suffered some damage.
Okay, so when that emulsion falls off from the surface,
yes,
then you end up with something like this.
Yes, interruptions mm-hmm, in the image. Mm-hmm. We don't see this on
There's
the
no evidence of that
yes,
on the shroud.
Yes, and I also must say that every painting suffers certain damages with time.
Mm-hmm.
The shroud shows no such damages. Every medium shows damages which are typical. You can tell that only egg tempera suffers this kind of damage, only glue tempera, only oil, only. We don't see these things.
Right.
Now here I try to rebut those who say that the shroud was painted with an iron oxide with very diluted emulsion, just a little bit of water, and that's all. That's how it would look.
Mm-hmm.
You can tell that a very light, diluted emulsion does not tie the pigments to the ground. Simply, it's not tied. You can wipe it off, it remains water soluble.
So we're looking at this face image here, and this is... And you're saying that this is produced how?
This is produced with an iron oxide, very strongly diluted.
A diluted iron oxide, okay.
Yes, very little gum, and the rest is water. And if you touch this painting...
It just comes right off.
It just comes off.
Okay,
and so
some of the contrary theories to the shroud is that there's iron oxide paint or paint on the shroud from iron oxide particles, and what
yes,
you're suggesting here is that even that would have wiped off, it would have come off, and
yes,
and one of the things that we find about the shroud image is that the image is totally stable. It's
yes,
whether you douse it with water, like what happened after the
fire
in 1532, yes, or everything we've done to the shroud indicates that image is completely stable.
Okay. Exactly. So that's what
okay,
I tried to show here. Also, another argument against those who claim that the shroud is a painting, that it is always the paint particles which are inside agglomerate, and the outside is the paint emulsion. While Mac Crone, for instance, claimed that he found inside of paint particles some kind of gooey yellow material. That was not paint. I am sorry.
What you're saying here is that paint, if it was paint, you would have the actual pigment particles
yes,
surrounded by the emulsion.
Exactly. Yes.
And
not the opposite.
And not the opposite. And
yes.
And
yes.
And okay,
yes,
so
yes,
that's a very good
that's
point.
That's another argument. And another strong argument that some of the people who tried to prove that the shroud was a painting or some man-made item, they get their ideas from very old books, such as Cennino Cennini,
mm-hmm,
who wrote this book, which I'm showing here on the slide, in 1437. And he was born in 1377, I guess, and he wrote the book in 1437.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's very dangerous to base a technique on these old books unless you really are a high-class professional and you understand what the expressions are in these old books. Some of these expressions are not understandable anymore. They were written in old Italian. Some of the techniques are non-existent anymore. They are obsolete. So I use a very great example. Leonardo da Vinci was commissioned to paint a mural, the Battle of Anghiari in Florence,
mm-hmm,
at the Palazzo Vecchio. And he read something in Pliny, and he thought that he can paint on the wall with certain oils which were boiled, and then when the painting was finished, They brought in these huge containers, iron containers, filled with burning coal, and they created great heat underneath the mural. And supposedly, as he translated and understood Plinius, this was great. This should have made the painting permanent for good. Instead, the painting started to run, and it was destroyed. So you cannot use an old technique dug out from Pliny or Cennini or Eastland or somebody unless you really know what you are doing, and even then it's dangerous.
And then is there any relationship with what you just said about this, about the hot coals, with the fact that the shroud was in a fire in 1532, and even part of the image itself was burned?
No, I am rather referring Ross to these techniques where they claim that with jeweler's powder they can create the shroud image, because it was described by Cennini, and Macron, for instance, refers to old techniques described by Cennini and Eastland. They don't even understand what Cennini and Eastland was referring.
And for the sake of those watching the Shroud Report, we'll have to say that Walter Macron is a microscopist who has for a long time claimed that the shroud is an artwork, and the mysterious painter used red ochre paint to construct the image, but unfortunately for Walter Macron, that doesn't bear up with any other avenue of scientific research. His claims have pretty much gone unsubstantiated by anyone else who's been analyzing the shroud image. Let me ask you: Go ahead.
I like to demonstrate this point.
Okay. All right.
With the shroud. Now he showed in his book this mural, which is in the Palace of the Popes in Avignon.
Macron showed it.
Yes,
in his book. Okay.
Yes, and he claims that look, this is how they painted in those years, with monochrome, just one red ochre color. Mm-hmm. I can prove on my own mural that every artist starts like this. First, you paint up your mural in monochrome.
I see.
If it's a fresco mural, that's how you do it, even with fresco.
So you would start with monochrome and then build in other colors later.
Exactly.
Okay, so it's like the monochrome is part of the blueprint of the original painting, and then you build in color and texture after you create the original monochrome version of the painting.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. And so here I show on this slide that the old masters, the way they painted, you see the monochrome in the shadowy center. Mm-hmm. That is an undercoat. And then the rest of it is a coat over and above this. They replastered the wall, and what was below, they painted it on the top, and they put the colors in. So this explains to you the whole technique, just like we said.
Okay.
And if for any reason the artist, for instance, died, he was not paid for, or he had to leave, or there was a separation of the coats, and any way, if the mural remained unfinished, then you see the monochrome exposed, like on this painting, where the top coat detached itself.
And the monochrome here is this image of this person that's all like in kind of like a reddish color, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So this has absolutely nothing to do with the Turin Shroud. Macron is wrong. I'm sorry. And I also like to point out that all these things prove that the shroud is really not a painting. You have to listen to a professional artist who actually has in her or his power to create these paintings. We know what is and what is not a painting. I really feel that the shroud is so mysterious that we didn't even start to understand it. And all the answers are not in the past. In vain we turn to the past. They all are in the future. And the more we find out about it, the more we have to know. And so I always call it, that's one of my favorite expressions, that the Shroud is the blueprint of the future.
Blueprint of the future. I think that's a wonderful way for us to conclude, Isabel. And I want to thank you for joining us here on the Shroud Report. It's been a delightful time to have you here. And we'll be right back in just a minute. This is Russ Brialt, and welcome back to the Shroud Report. Our guest today has been Isabel Pitsek, a professional artist and a world-renowned artist, in fact. I want to thank you for being here. You have really enlightened me, and I hope everyone watching. You know, your last comment before we had the break was that the answer to the Shroud is not in the past, but in the future. And there's something about you that we didn't talk about, and that is not only are you an artist, but you're also a physicist. It's not very often that you get a physicist and an artist in the same body. And, you know, I imagine that there's a lot more you'd like to talk about regarding what you think may be some of the physics involved in the image.
Yes.
And but I think we're going to have to save that for another Shroud Report.
Thank you so much, Russ, for inviting me. It was an honor.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's been a delight.
Thank you.